Hi guys, welcome to another episode of LaFort Daily Demos. Today I'm going to teach you how to build a one-point perspective grid using a measuring point and measuring point control system. So first thing we want to do is, I've got a sheet of paper here. This is 14 by 17 inch paper, bond paper. We just want to get started with our rough layout. I'm not going to get too concerned about the size of the drawing at the moment. Although you do want to plan ahead, but until you learn the system, it's very difficult to plan ahead. So I'm going to get started. I'm going to use some colored pencils just to try to coordinate aesthetically what you can see. So first thing I'm going to start with is a ground line, something like that. So imagine this is the back edge of the room that we're going to build. Usually we use one-point perspective for interior spaces, but not always. You can use one-point perspective for designing cars and motorcycles and things too, but for this demo I'm going to do an interior space. Perpendicular to that, I'm going to draw a vertical line. So imagine that as the representation of the left wall in this case, and it would be very useful now to start thinking about an architectural scale. So I'm using this ruler because you can see it a little bit clearer at home. Typically, I'm going to switch colors here to a red pencil for my horizon line. So typically, we want to have a 5 foot eye level when it comes to architectural spaces. So I'm going to use half inch equals 1 foot. So that's actually 2 feet, 4 feet, 5 feet is there. So let me use this end of the scale so you can actually see the numbers a little bit easier. So that would be 5 feet at half inch equals 1 foot. So I'm going to let's do a 10-foot ceiling, and that would be 5 inches, would equal 10 feet. So half inch, again, half inch equals 1 foot. There's my horizon line. And let's go ahead and add another foot or two above, make it a 12-foot ceiling. We'll see how that plays out. We maybe can use that up the road, just add a couple extra feet. Okay, so let's go ahead and extend this wall a little bit higher here. My horizon line again is 5 feet, so that is here. Okay, there's my horizon line. And at this point I can go ahead and strike in the horizontal line up here at the ceiling. And then you might want to start to decide how wide is your space. Maybe you happen to know how wide it is. So again, using half inch equals a foot, if I go 5 inches, that would be 10 feet. 6 would be 12 feet, so I've got a big square. So let's do a 10 foot, or we'll just make it a little less than that. We'll make it 11 feet. So that's 11 feet in this case. Go ahead and put these little half inch increments. So these are measuring increments that would coordinate with your architectural plan. Okay, so my horizon line here is in red, and my vertical measuring line, my ceiling line, edges of the room are in blue. So here's the edges of my room. So now along your horizon line, and preferably between the walls, you want to insert a vanishing point. Typically, we don't want to do it dead center because it's a little bit boring if it's just dead center. You can shift it to the left, shift it to the right, you can shift it a little bit to the right, you can shift it a lot to the right. So let's shift it to the left in this case, okay? I'm shifting it to the left. So this is my vanishing point. And again, this is one vanishing point here. So from that vanishing point, you now just simply put your pencil on that intersection on the horizon line. Draw forward from that intersection on the floor. You could do the same thing on this side. So that's the representation of our floor plane. The ceiling is up here, up above us. And the ceiling is coming out towards us that way. Okay? If we had a lower ceiling, such as an 8-foot ceiling, here's 5, 6, 7, 8 would be a typical, maybe a residential apartment. 9 feet would be a little bit of a higher ceiling. 10 feet would be there again. So we can shift this ceiling around all we want. We can bring it down to bring it deeper into the, or lower into the scene if we need to. So we're off to a good start. We have the representation of a right wall, a left wall, a ceiling, and the floor plane. We can certainly continue the ground plane towards the horizon line into the distance to, say, construct a balcony outside this space. There's no reason that you have to be stuck inside the walls, necessarily. There could be a balcony out there. What we do need, though, is a set of a kind of proportioning system for our grid module or our box. So if these are, imagine floor tiles, or maybe even hardwood floor. These are 1 foot increments radiating out from the vanishing point towards us. And that's representing our ground plane, our floor plane. And what we now want is a way of understanding what a square is across this floor plane. And we can bring this up the wall too. So along the wall, while I'm here, would be like this. So say you have a brick wall or cement block or some other kind of horizontal linear kind of pattern. It's going to radiate out towards us, out from the vanishing point like this. Okay, so I'll finish out the wall and the ceiling plane and things a little bit more in a minute. But we need to work out what our module is. So in other words, if we had on the flat plane across the back wall, those same grid lines or guidelines come across horizontally like this, and vertically they go up the back wall like that. And of course I could put tick marks at the ceiling, so I can start to map corresponding edges across the ceiling plane as well. Okay, so I'm drawing a little bit light. I hope it's visible through the video camera on your display. I'm keeping it a little bit light because I always want to start sketching into this, or lay some trace paper over the top and use it as an underlay to start sketching some ideas. And if it gets too dark, then, or too heavy, my line work is too heavy, then it really kind of ruins my ability to see through my system, or I start to get really stuck on it. So we could have a ceiling that's up here like this. This is the representation of the lines coming forward. So what we need now is a way of representing each one of these 1 foot grid boxes that's on a flat plane in the back to the horizontal and vertical planes that are coming out towards us in space. So you can eyeball this, although it's very prone to errors, but generally the more mechanical method is you take the distance from the vanishing point to that longest corner of the room on the floor, that distance, and that's a little bit beyond the limit of this compass at the moment. So I'm just going to switch to a ruler and I'm just going to measure it. So on this ruler I can measure from here to the vanishing point, it's about 5 inches, and I just swing that 5-inch dimension up here to the horizon line. So 5 inches out here is there, and then I double that distance. So it's that again out here to the right. So it's actually right there on my page. So out here is a control point, CP, or a diagonal vanishing point. Some people refer to it as a measuring point. Making some notes there. I know that's very, very small on the screen, but that's what I've written. CP for control point, DVP for diagonal vanishing point, or MP for measuring point. From that vanishing point, you're going to come back through this corner. So across the ground plane, basically that's what we're really representing. Across the ground plane, we're now getting intersections across the grid, all the way across the grid, or these radiating lines towards the vanishing point. Every one of those intersections is now a valid horizontal line mark where I can now build my ground plane boxes or squares like that. So I'm just moving upward. I've already got the tick marks in there. So each of these horizontal lines, I'll take the T-square away in a second here. Each of these boxes corresponds with a unit on the back wall. Okay? So, we're in good shape. Kind of building sort of like the holodeck on Star Trek. Any Star Trek fans out there? You know what I'm talking about? The holodeck. That's kind of it. We're just building a representation of that in this system here. And you can see this is a bit, you know, there's a lot of work to building a grid in a lot of ways. It can go very quickly. The better, the faster, the more you do it, the faster you get at it, all that sort of thing. Where they intersect the wall over here is a vertical line. So I can just carry my line work vertically. Try to be careful when you are drafting that you are not pivoting your pencil as you're making your line. You want to keep a nice, steady angle so that the tip is always at the same angle as you're drawing your line. If you roll your pencil, in other words, you make a line like this, then the line is not going to be straight. It's going to be curving up the page. And you're going to have poor construction. So you're going to have a very poor underlay, and it's going to degrade the quality and the accuracy of your drawing. Okay? I'm going to finish out the grid up here, up above. Again, back to the vanishing point. These radiating lines across the ceiling, maybe there's ceiling tiles, or it's just a module system, a modular system. So it allows me to start to place objects within this system. All right. So if I know the scale of a piece of furniture, which of course you have to do some research and look up the scale of furniture and things like that. But if you have the scale of some furniture, then you can start to locate it within the boxes. Now, very, very quickly, beginning students want to start to rotate an object relative to the grid and relative to the walls, and then you need to incorporate a little two-point perspective or overlay a little two-point perspective into it. And if you practice, you can kind of eyeball a lot of the proportions. And I'm going to walk you through a little bit of that so you can get a good feel for it. So here we are on the right wall. We can bring the grid forward. Now, I really caution against constructing the entire grid, because a lot of times you're going to discover that you spend a lot of time building all of these grid lines and you only use a very small fraction of them. So do this to get familiar with the system of construction. And I would recommend you play around with the eye level, the horizon line eye level. Again, horizon line equals eye level. That's the eye level of us, the viewer, into the scene. Okay, it's a really important concept. So I'm going to come back and I'm going to talk about that a little bit in this video as well. And this will overlap with other videos as I talk about these things over and over and demonstrate this in various different ways. I'm going to take the ticks on the horizontal, the vertical wall over on the left side across the back wall. And again, I can draw them very light, because what if this whole back wall is just glass? Maybe then I don't want all these lines cutting across my drawing. So I just need the geometry translated to the right side of the drawing so that I can carry my grid lines outward from the vanishing point and across the right wall. So you should have a grid that's kind of that looks something along these lines. Remember, in one point vanishing point or one point construction, one point perspective, there's only one vanishing point, effectively one vanishing point. This is a diagonal vanishing point over here on the right, but the starting point for the system is a single vanishing point at the center of the scene. So we're basically staring at the back wall, straight onto the back wall. The rules of the system are that all the horizontal lines are simply parallel to the horizon line, just like that. Okay? And then anything perpendicular to horizontal is now fading away to that vanishing point. The diagonal vanishing point is essentially a diagonal cut through our square. So if this is our grid, the diagonal vanishing point gives us a diagonal line cutting across the grid like that. And we can use that geometry to extend our grid as well. Okay? Going back to some basic fundamentals of geometry. So that's it. That's our one-point perspective grid. And again, we can change the horizon line or the eye level. We can move that down to a 3-foot eye level if we are sitting. We can move it up to a 10-foot eye level if we are up on a slight rise or like a higher deck and the ground is down lower. This might be the ground down below. Then we'd be looking down in the space. Typically, though, our eye level is something like this. It's 5 feet. That's kind of a good average height for a typical person in our culture. I'm going to draw some people in here, and I'm going to do some really loose, stylized, sketched people to give you a sense of representation and space and scale. So, if our eye level is here, the head goes through, the eyes go through the horizon line, and the head kind of splits that. And then I always like to draw like a little airspace because we always kind of draw necks too thick. So give yourself a little airspace to the head, draw a torso. Now the height of a head is 1 unit. Torso is approximately 2.5 units. And then our legs extend down about another 3.5 units, okay? You should wind up with a body or a figure that is approximately 7 to 8 heads high. Fashion models, fashion designers maybe use 8 or 9 heads even for their really long, slender figures. All right, so you don't have to get too caught up in what the figure is doing in the space. You don't have to get caught up in their fashion or their hairstyle. Just start to mess around with looking at figures and their proportions, okay? So you don't wind up with big, mutant-sized heads with little cartoonish legs and feet or something. A little stylized figure is fine, it's up to you, okay? So this is an eye level of 5 feet. This person is obviously a little bit taller than 5 feet if that's their head, maybe 5'4" or so. So if you wanna have another person standing next to them, it's a little bit taller, you just draw the head a little bit taller, bring the torso in and extend the legs down. And again, they're standing on the floor. So somebody farther away, let's say they're outside this glass wall, their eye level, their head, is still at the same eye level, assuming that they are standing on the same level ground, and then where their legs touch the floor, that's where they're standing. So there's a little shadow there. Give these guys a little shadow so you can see them maybe a little bit better in the rendering or in the video, okay? So very important concept. Remember, bring the feet towards the horizon line, not the head. You don't want to make the people, a person in the foreground is not this big. Okay, this is a common error. Okay, I should red flag that. Common error is to draw the person closer to us like this. If my person was this big, it would suggest, I can measure the height of this person, it would suggest that our horizon line is almost 10 or 11, maybe even 12 feet, okay? And we're looking down on this figure. A person closer to us should be represented by a larger head and the shoulders, okay? And that's like a suggestion of the figure in the foreground, off to the right, looking into the space. So it's very important, scale up the head as they get closer to us, okay? Again, you don't have to get too caught up on what the hair is doing. At this point, you can use entourage, underlay tracings to start to flush in your figures and things like that, okay? For scaling objects within this space, we now have a system, we have a unit. So if I know that there's a chair, let's just put a chair in the space here, and I know that the chair is, let's say, 18 inches tall, the seat is 18 inches tall, I can go over here to this wall grid unit, which is here, that's 1 foot, that's 18 inches, a foot and a half, and I can carry that line horizontally out. So a chair is going to be 1.5 units. A typical chair is about 18 inches, 17 to 18 inches square, more or less, and 18 inches off the floor. So this is 18 inches based on the wall, based on the unit on the wall. So a chair might have approximately that dimension right there. And I can go back to the vanishing point for the seat. That's the seat base, and then if you want to start to add like a little slant for the seat to feel a little bit more relaxed and it has a little bit of curvature, or you want to start to detail it, you build off of that block or off of that box. So now you know where the back leg is. Very important, remember the back leg is touching here, 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 and here. So if I come in and I erase some of this construction work, Aesthetically, that's where the legs touch the floor. Here, 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 and here. So if I want to angle the legs a little bit, I can just start to pyramid them out a little bit. I want to add a seat back, so I'm going to come back up, and a seat back is another 18 inches higher, more or less. Again, some seats might have a lower back, some might have a higher, taller back. So I can now take the vertical height of this leg, and I can carry it I can double that height right there, and I can eyeball that. That vertical length I can trust. So I can double that, and then I go back to my vanishing point, and I flush in a back. Now that's not a very comfortable back, so maybe I can arc it a little bit, or I could slant it and arc it a little bit, and that would give it a little bit more comfortable representation. And then remember, all boxy edges have three edges, and whereas tubes have a little bit of an arc and a round at the bottom. So that gets into more form logic, geometry, and things that are covered in other videos. So I'm just starting to render in or shade in some values, just so you can see the planes and the seat and the curvature and things like that starting to emerge. So a good point of reference would be to compare the scale of the people that are pretty close to standing next to it. And if they feel about right, then you're in good shape. Okay? So that's how you scale and start to build and modify and work into your system. Remember, if you have a ceiling light, maybe there's a recessed light in here. You see, we always sketch in our ellipses with the minor axis vertical, the major axis horizontal. And as that circle comes forward, it gets more round. But we still try to hold on to that minor axis vertical, major axis horizontal. So this could be like a canister recess light up in the ceiling. Just cylinder logic. And then maybe those are creating a little illumination over here on the wall. So I like to give it a little arc, kind of like that. So I just think about where is that maybe touching the wall and coming forward in this case. So in this case, I would render the wall a little bit darker and let that area of illuminance kind of burn out in my rendering a little bit. So that's a little bit about light logic right there. So again, let's go back to building this space a little bit more. I was starting to build earlier on a patio deck outside. So if I build the patio out here, I can carry my grid farther into the distance to the vanishing point. I can carry my grid this direction. Using my diagonal vanishing point, I can come back across here, and everywhere it bisects there and this grid line, I can start to create my module into the distance too. So there's two units. Carry another grid line. There's three units. That would be a 3-foot patio or terrace or balcony. That would be 4. And this would be a 5-foot balcony right there. So now I draw a horizontal line across there. And that balcony, let's just give it a handrail so we can start to see that handrail. The handrail is typically about 3 feet, so there's 1 feet, 2 feet, 3 feet. Carry 3 feet back to your vanishing point. So this right here might be I'll draw it with vertical lines. That might be my handrail. Vertical bars. Of course, the handrail needs a little bit of dimension, so I can start to flush in some depth, some thickness, some width, all that kind of stuff. And then that's 3 feet in the distance. It's in front of this guy, so I'll go ahead and remember the top plane will be barely visible, but then I'll see more of the vertical plane of that railing, sort of like that. And again, I'm just gonna go ahead and block in some vertical rungs, or vertical structural pieces to the railing, so you can start to see it. And I'm just eyeballing the spacing at the moment. Normally, I would spend a little bit more time and use my scaling method for controlling the spacing of those. And maybe I'll add another detail, which is another horizontal bar across here. And at this point, I'm just eyeballing what I think is like 6 to 9 inches or so. And again, you can, when you have more time, you can you can spend that time and do everything a little bit more precisely using measurements and things. So. So there you can start to see the handrail emerging in the distance, okay? Again, in a lot of my videos, I like to draw some sort of mountains in the backgrounds for some reference. So there's, you know, we live here in Southern California in Long Beach, and I like to imagine that we can see Catalina Island off in the distance out at the ocean. We've got beachfront property or something like that. It gives a nice sense of the sky and the earth, and maybe there's a beach, the waves washing into the shore. So I can start to render in and get that idea in there, and I can even start to put some ships in the distance and some scale and oil rigs and all that kind of stuff. So we can start to flesh in a narrative, you know, have some fun with it, or if your project is very specific, site specific, then really tap into that local community or environment. I'm gonna go ahead and add some more geometries in here, use up a few more minutes of this video. Say I want to step the ceiling down over here, I can come down. Oops, I would like to use the blue pencil there, just to be consistent with the main room geometries versus starting to flesh in other things. So I came in 1-2, so that would be a 2-foot step in. Maybe there's a drop down, and there's 1 foot, a foot and a half, 2 feet on the back wall. And of course, that's where the grid line is right there. So that would be a 2-foot step down, and 18 inches would be right there. So in this case, I'm just eyeballing what I think is maybe a nice drop down soffit in the space. So that's a vertical plane right there. And then that could carry over to the wall. And where it intersects the wall, that comes back out. So again, now I can start to sketch in. I could put some recessed lighting in here, up above. And again, those are gonna create a little cast on the wall. Something like that. That'd be nice for my rendering as I move forward. If I wanna put a piece of artwork on the wall, then I just come back out from the vanishing point. Let's just say, again, this eye level is 5 feet. So let's say we have a TV and it's mounted where the top of the TV is 5.5 feet, which would be there. And maybe the TV is, I don't know, I should go measure a television, but let's just say that it's a really widescreen television. It happens to exist right there. What is that? That's 2.5 feet tall. Seems a little bit short. That's okay. So if I add some depth or thickness to the television, don't get confused by this line right here. This is my perspective coming off of the vanishing point. Horizontal lines, the depth of the television, it goes back to being horizontal right there. It's a little horizontal edge. So this is the end plane of the television. Okay. And a great rendering trick, I'm going to go ahead and add a slight thin frame on the television. And I'm just going to eyeball what I think is about right for the... I'm adjusting for foreshortening the front edge versus the back edge. And I want to give an illusion that this television is also floating off of the wall. So I'm going to create a little shadow. And this little horizontal is going to create a little angle here. And then I'm going to carry that down, and I'm going to make it a long, long shadow because these lights are close to the wall. And I'm going to go ahead, and this is all going to get rendered in, especially when it comes to my final rendering. So as I work, you can see I'm working right on the grid at the moment. I would recommend you actually lay some trace paper over your grid and start sketching onto your trace paper rather than onto your grid directly, because you can always use your grid for another project once you've done this. But it's a little bit faster for my demo here to just kind of build that in. Now, televisions, a great trick for rendering televisions is to just put a strong glare across here or any glass screen and get pretty gutsy with rendering that that black screen, basically. So, no other way to describe it other than be gutsy with your value scale. Okay, so nice strong glare. You can soften that transition up right there if you want. You can come over to the other side of the television, create another strong glare over here. Now, if you know mirror plane reflection logic, you can certainly include that into your renderings. So in other words, the handrail right here would maybe appear in the reflection of the television here. You could start to consider the if the figures may appear as a ghost in here or not, a little subtle shade. So I'm not going to get into all that in this video. I'm just trying to help the viewers see the grid, establish some proportions, understand how to build out, how to utilize the grid, and locate their furniture within it, and have some approximate scale for things. Okay, so I hope that helps. We're at 31 minutes. I'm gonna do something else here really quickly. I'm gonna go ahead and take this wall on the left, and right here, 1, 2, 3, 4 feet out, I'm just gonna put an edge in here real quick. And I'm gonna show you that this could be a wall that cuts across here. The ceiling is now continuous across here. And the space on the other side of the wall could continue over here. So perhaps this is a room with a second room next to it over here. So now your grid, your floor plan grid, continues over here. I eyeballed what is about a 6-inch thick wall. So I'm also showing this because I really want young designers to realize the grid is just a starting point for a set of references, a set of proportions. And don't confuse now these guidelines that are up the wall with the guidelines that are on the floor, okay? So if we had hardwood flooring on the floor, hardwood flooring, maybe like 4-inch wide boards or so. So I'll just sort of eyeball what is about a 4-inch. And now the wood grain is going to run in that direction towards the vanishing point. Okay, so you can eyeball 4 inches, use your vanishing point, control the floorboards coming out towards us. Forget about that little guy that's completely wrong. Now, that's very different than putting a child in the narrative or in the place, in the space. A child next to this couple, for example, may have slightly shorter proportions, okay? So that's fine. They break the rules. Children, as you get younger and younger, the proportions are definitely shorter and shorter. So instead of a child being 7 heads, it's more like 5 heads, or as you get down to a toddler, it's like maybe 3 heads or something for a child. So their proportions change, and you should really pick up an anatomy book and study anatomy to get a better feel for that. So there's our ground plane now moving across into this room. I could now put, I'm just going to ad lib my drawing here, from the vanishing point, another wall over here. Just helping you see that you can build out your space. Again, the grid is just a starting point, and it is malleable. If you have very specific dimensions that you're working with, then start with that. But really think outside of the view too. So now you can really see this is an end plane of that wall. Got a neighbor dog active tonight, I guess. Probably barking at squirrels. So this is the end plane of the wall. I'll render it there a little bit, and I'll render it down here at the floor, and I'm just gonna leave that alone for now. Again, I'm just doing this to pull the values out so you can see the walls, okay? So build your drawing, have fun. Again, have an active imagination, like I always say. And shoot me any questions. Have fun. Bye.